information that you give to mothers, especially when they're trying to do things such as breastfeeding, and if they're first mothers and they don't have a lot of support, they might still ask me some questions. So the first thing I want to do is to be able to assess. So if I'm going to be assessing whether or not want to start breastfeeding the baby or giving formula, of course there's certain cultural and religious beliefs that you need to be aware of, and more cultural, and some, you know, cultures, specifically the Asian culture, prefer to do formula feeding rather than breastfeeding. A lot of the people that I've encountered who are Asian and traditional Asian, specifically the Chinese, it seems that the formula business over there is really steeped in tradition. Who breastfeed are more known or more seen to be a little bit more rural and not as, let's say, affluent, because they don't have access to breastfeed. Basically, they see it as somewhat primitive, whereas formula is more sophisticated. However, in the United States, we really do encourage a lot of breastfeeding, specifically since this, it's just has a lot more immunity and it has a lot more nutrients available to the baby. Plus, it's been used for generations and studies have proven that it is much more superior. However, that's of course up to your patient. So for interventions, what we're gonna do is hopefully we talk to the mother and discuss that she wants to do breastfeeding first. So you can try to do an intervention for breastfeeding immediately after the baby has been born. Ready, clean, and bonding skin to skin with the mother. Even run on the delivery table if possible. Go ahead and start that breastfeeding. I'll talk about that procedure for breastfeeding later in another video. But other things to consider are the rest of the interventions, which is to stay with the client each time she nurses until she feels secure and confident in feeding her own newborn. And assess the latch, which is to latch achieved by the newborn, audible swallowing, type of nipple, comfort of the mother, and holding or the position of the baby. I think for the hospital that I've done my clinicals at, they really do prefer the football hold. All right, so there might be some uterine cramping that may occur the first day after birth while the client is nursing, but this is probably most likely to the oxytocin wearing off. If the mother was using some oxytocin prior to giving birth to encourage labor. Then also use a hygiene. Only wash the breasts about once a day. Excessive washing is not necessary. But soap is discouraged, but I think I've read somewhere that there's barely any soap that's only soap. Most soaps that are available over the counter in many drugstores usually have some moisturizer on them, so it's I think a little bit more safer to use that kind of soap if the mother feels like it. However, there's always body wash, and basically the main purpose that we're doing that is because we don't want the mother's breasts and nipples and areola to have any cracks due to dry skin. This encourages an open incision for viruses and vectors and bacteria to seep through, and could lead to possible complications for breastfeeding. And so if engorgement occurs, let's say it's the breasts become large, it can cause a lot of pain for the mother, not only because of the size, but also because of a lot of, you know, complications that will come with it. So usually the standard interventions to educate the patient is to breastfeed frequently. Of course, we're going to use the baby to pace however much the baby wants to eat or breastfeed. There's no set schedule that you need to really make the infant adhere to, because the infant's not going to listen to you. However, there are some things that you can do to help the teach the mother to mitigate the possible complications of breastfeeding. So if there is engorgement, then have the mother encourage more warm packs on the breasts in order to prepare it, and then have the baby feed. After the baby feeds, then use ice packs to prevent further inflammation and try to decrease the pain. After that, encourage the client to massage the breasts in order to increase the circulation. If cracked nipples do develop, then you can have the mother expose the breast to air, just to open air, for about 10 to 20 minutes. And when the baby switches to the next breast, then make sure that the baby is suckling on the breast by having a secure seal around the areola and not just the nipple. Because, I mean, I can imagine as a male nurse that it would be pretty painful to just have the baby suckle on the nipple. You need to make sure the baby's lips are around the areola as well. Next, encourage the mother to have a well-fitting bra. This is nothing that's too tight, but just snug enough. Really discourage the use of a wire bra. The most useful would just be a nice, well-fitting bra. And I think it's just better for me as a male nurse to just say well-fitting, because it leaves the interpretation of those words to the patient themselves. They know exactly what bra is well-fitting for them. Also, this probably has been covered during a talks prior to giving birth, but we really do encourage the increase of around 500 kilocalories per day, which is 500 calories a day when the mother is breastfeeding. However, this can be confused. Well, I confuse this as that during the first trimester of pregnancy, the increased calorie for a normal for a woman with a normal BMI is usually around 200 calories. So you don't increase to 500 calories until the mother is actually really breastfeeding, because you're feeding for two. And also prenatal vitamins, and also pushing fluids. Of course, these should hopefully have been covered during prenatal visits. Another thing that the mother will probably be asking is that what does an infant's stool look like? Well, they usually look like, they look like little seeds, or yellow, they're watery, and they're pretty frequent. I've heard some information say that it's around one every hour, but things change, and it's different for different people. But basically, frequently is the word that's most used. Medications, over-the-counter medications, I hear a lot of conflicting information about this as well. For the most part, unnecessary over-the-counter medications are discouraged for mothers due to the fact that a lot of these medications can seep through to the nipple area and through the mammary ducts, and the baby will also consume these same medications. I think pain medications, I'll have to look it up somewhere, there's different. Basically, what you're looking for is that you're trying to make sure that the baby's liver that's immature and undeveloped is not taxed by any unnecessary medications that really shouldn't be there. Next, gas-producing foods and caffeine should be avoided. I don't know exactly how well parents and the mothers will really adhere to that, but if they ask, just say that it's discouraged. Oral contraceptives containing estrogen are not recommended for breastfeeding mothers due to the different hormones and the hormonal change that the mother's body is undergoing. And also, if they do want to have some oral contraceptives, then try to direct them to more progestin-only birth control pills. Which will be less likely to interfere with the milk producing aspect, so the baby can breastfeed well. And then finally, have the infant determine when it wants to eat. So the mother, it's going to be something between the mother and the baby, and it's another part of bonding. We just want to empower the mothers to understand that the baby will make it known that the baby will want to eat and breastfeed. Okay, so Just another extra layer of comfort and education for the new mother or the mother who is just asking for basic.